Okay, we are on the record. This is the matter of Angela Voss and Bobby Knight, cause number 20-3-178-23. Got for the court today on an ongoing bench trial. It is streaming live on the Zoom channel. There is only court personnel in the session at this time. It's also occurring with the parties present in the courtroom. And I'm just reviewing the exhibit list. And what happened is that during the most recent break in this trial, the clerk went through the exhibits to determine which exhibits have been provided, and we're dealing with the sub exhibits, recognizing that many exhibits were had been marked with a host of different documents in them, and some of those documents were admitted, and some of those documents were not, and so documents were created with the letter designation after the number, and the parties are to provide those documents as exhibits. And so we have a list. So preliminarily, I'd like to deal with that first before we get started on anything else today. Okay, so I will begin with number 54A. And Ms. Voss, I think that that is your exhibit.
Yes, I believe so. Would you like for me to show it to Mr. Knight first?
I would, if you would, please. I see a page 16 in here.
I had question marks on my notes, so okay. I included them.
16, 17, and 18 are not included in our, our sheet here, but let me look at my notes here, so double check it. Okay. 16 and 18 were withdrawn.
Okay.
So, or 16 through 18 were withdrawn. So, pull that. Okay, everything else looks like it's in order, so the court will have the clerk mark 54K and admit that, or it's already been admitted, I guess. And we'll just wait until the clerk is able to do that before we move on to our next one. So our next one I want to address, and I think that we just have, indicates that we have two copies of 85C. If I could take a look at both those copies to make sure they're identical. And do we show these being admitted at two different times? Or it was admitted once and then it was followed up with a document I'm anticipating.
Unfortunately, I wasn't the clerk.
That's probably what happened. She didn't see it in there.
Yeah.
They just put it in there. Okay. So. I think that we'll just keep the one that. Oh, they both said the same thing. And I'll just make this a bench copy. Okay. Okay, so Ms. Voss, excuse me, our next one is 87A. Do you have
it?
Okay. So the court has received now 87A. It is in accordance with the early admitted 87A, so I'll have the clerk mark that as well. Okay, Mr. Knight, number 232A.
Unfortunately, sir, it slipped to my mind and I did not get that.
Okay. And that is pages 3 through 6 of 232. Thank you. Ms. Voss. 320A. Do you have that document? And that is the Our Family Wizard calendar.
That would be sitting on my desk.
Okay, so we have that one to follow up with. Okay, so Ms. Voss, the next one would be 395C.
I have that here. Okay, this is a little bit different than what the court authorized. It looks like I might be missing a Gmail from
2722.
Is that what's missing?
Okay, and so what the court admitted was part of the page of 3. And page 4 and page 5. And what I receive is page 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so we need 5. We need to get rid of page 2. And then I will redact the top portion of page 3. And so what it is messages. Step to find out if there's a further redaction. Well, why don't we start with that? Okay, so if you could take a look at that again, Ms. Voss, 395, page 3 is what you that you had in your new proposal is page two. Okay, so that should be your first page.
So page three should have the Skyward?
Yes, that's at the top.
Okay.
Again, I'll redact that, but that you could provide that, an entire page, and that'd be three, and then four is the page after that, and then five is the page after that. And so you'll need to add a page to it and take off a page.
So is page five an email titled My Evaluation from January 28th, 2020?
Which, again, I think I need to go back and look at my actual notes. What I'm relying upon are my notes on the exhibit list, so.
And I have written 395A on the bottom of that page.
Which could be. That was addressed on May 6th. So let me pull my May 6th notes. My notes confirm that. It is pages 3, 4, and 5. And again, I will redact the top portion of 3. So I'll give you back this.
Okay. What is 395A then if it's not page 5 here?
Would you please pull 395A, please? It is the bottom portion of page 5. Okay, so at this point, Ms. Voss, what I'm going to need to do is listen to the record, and I will, because it could be that I've wrote it down incorrectly twice in two different locations, and that's possible. And it may be that I did not recognize that page 5 was already admitted. So I can see why page 2 would not have been admitted, but I need to listen to the record.
Sure.
I know what time it was,
okay.
So it shouldn't take me too long to find that. So at this juncture, if you could go ahead and add page 5, that way, regardless what happens, we know we have enough pages.
Thank you, Your Honor.
appears to be what we have. So you have another one that you believe is...
I do.
Okay, which number is that?
I had 395A on it.
395A, I just looked at.
Right, so if that is page 5 of this...
It is.
Then...
Oh, so you have everything then, by doing that. Okay, okay, very good. Okay, so we won't mark this yet. I'm just going to hang on to it until I have a chance to listen to that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so just give me a moment to contact court administration.
I had a couple other things on the exhibit list.
Okay.
Exhibits 216 and 218. The exhibit list notes, they're all Northwest Asthma and Allergy letters from 216, 217, and 218. But my records indicate that 218 was actually a letter from Asthma and Allergy Specialty Services. And I thought both 216 and 218 were admitted.
So you thought that what are admitted?
Both 216 and 218.
Okay. Do you have the date that you believe that 216 was admitted?
5/11.
Could you pull 218, Madam Clerk?
Did you say 218?
218. are correct in that the on 218, it is allergy and asthma specialty service. So I'll have the clerk rename that. Exhibit based upon the heading of that letter.
Two 217 was discussed, and I thought that might have been.
I think 217 was the termination letter, which was included in the Northwest Asthma and Allergy records.
So it was found in another document.
Right, but the communication expectations.
Was 216 found in another document also that we debated?
Well, and so I'm looking at my notes of the time period that we admitted 218, which was on May 11th, and there's no mention of 216 in the, oh, there is, okay. It was addressed at about 3:45, but there was no request to admit it.
Okay. I don't know if now is an appropriate time to offer that or.
No objection. Not right now. Make a
okay.
note of that, and
okay.
then we will come back to it. I'm just dealing with preliminaries
yep.
right now, and that gets back into
sure.
the meetings.
I had a question on 352B.
352D as in dog?
B as in boy.
That is highlighted. Why don't we pull up 352B? Okay, I'm looking at 352B, and what is your question?
It looks like that is the same as 79B, and I don't know if it's just,
And that might be the case.
Offered subsequently.
I do recall that, and I'm not sure whether May 5th was it, the very last day of trial, there were several documents that the court admitted recognizing that may be involved in some other documents simply because
right.
for us to go through and try to find those was just becoming
right.
way too time consuming.
Sure.
Okay. And so it's not my preference by any means to have two documents that are the same because it creates a difficult record
right.
when parties are arguing about, I mean, unfortunately I've seen it happen where we have two documents identical, not recognizing it. One party argues about it, document A, another party argues about document B, and I don't make the connection until later that we're arguing about the same document. Okay, and so, and that is a concern. Identifying these are really a good thing to do. What is it the same as?
79B.
Okay, so these are a good note to make, because if you're gonna make on your closing argument, addressing a document, recognizing it someplace else. It's always helpful for me to know that. Okay, so, and I tried really hard to a point not to have that happen. But thank you for pointing that out.
You're welcome. And I think that was it for my notes.
any other preliminary issues, Ms. Knight?
Ms. Voss, no.
Okay.
Yeah, I have
I'm
a
sorry,
question.
I'm sorry, Ms. Voss, Mr. Knight.
I have a question. It's concerning CRW 26.09.260, specifically under item 2, where item 2 states, in applying these standards, the court shall retain the residential schedule established by the degree of parenting plan, unless, then it goes on to state, the court has found the non-moving party in contempt of court at least twice within 3 years because the parent failed to comply with the residential time provision in the court order parenting plan, or the parent has been convicted of custodial interference in the first or second degree under RCW 9A.40.060 or 9A.40.070. We have testimony already in this case that was presented on Friday that Ms. Voss was found in contempt twice since November 30th, 2021. She testified to it. During this trial, she has not followed the parenting plan by not following an agreement when we took agreed to change Chloe and Hayden on bus, and at 6 o'clock, Ms. Voss refused, decided not to do co-parenting and called Mr. Knight and had him come back an hour early. She interfered with the parenting plan. She has now withheld medications from Chloe, causing her to have an incident at school, blaming the incident on school, on the side effects of the medication. She now has taken Chloe, since she has turned 13, to the doctor's office on a walk-in clinic on Saturday, and on Monday had the doctor had Chloe taken completely off the medication that was proven to be positive for her. Ms. Voss has put my children's life into danger, and the court seems to have aided her in the effect by not following this court rule, because this trial should not have happened, because Ms. Voss had been found in contempt of court twice.
I don't need to hear a response with regard to RCW 2609260, subsection 2, subsection D. This is the criteria the court has to apply in this trial, and that is the mandate is the court to retain the residential schedule, and then there's the unless, and that's where the burden shifts. Not shifts, burden is placed on the moving party, which is Ms. Voss as it relates to the modification. Okay. The subsection A, subsection B, I do not believe are being argued, and that's the parent agrees to modification, and B is the child's been integrated into family contrary to the parenting plan. Subsection C, the child's present environment is detrimental to the child's physical, mental, and emotional health, and harm likely to cause by a change in environment is outweighed by the advantage of the change to the child. That's that is the foundation of Ms. Voss's petition, or amended petition. Subsection D relates to a circumstance where the non-moving parent is in contempt of court at least twice. In the current scenario, you're the non-moving parent. So if you had been found in contempt of court twice for not following the parenting plan, and then if Ms. Voss would have brought the petition, that would have been a basis for an argument that a modification should be allowed. Subsection D, which allows for that, opens the door. It doesn't mean the court does it, but it opens the door so the court can consider it. The way the statute's created, a final plan is a final plan, folks. That's the way it is. A modification is a very steep hill to climb, okay? And so there's four pillars that you can jump onto in order to get to the top, and D is the non-moving party contempt, okay? Not the moving party contempt, okay? So this case is based, or at least the court has been framing it as under RCW 2609260, subsection 2. Subsection C. And we're about ready to get to the pending issue, which you've already started addressing, Mr. Knight. But before getting to that pending issue, I just wanted to clear the deck with everything else that may be preliminary. So is there anything else preliminary?
No. I just wanted to bring this forward because I wanted to understand why that did not apply, and because under my understanding, even if this is for the moving party, why is this not equally applied between the two? It would actually reduce the amount of conflict that family and family law would endure, and it would save economically for the society if these laws were applied equally among both parties on a situation where no attorneys are present. I believe that the court should at least look out for the economics of the county and not allow a trial to go for 17 days unduly because of biased rules set forth in our system. I believe that there should be an easier way that would not affect the outcome of my children's psyche or any other person's psyche that is involved in family court due to these rules being twisted so that the children can be used as pawns in a court battle between the parents.
Well, Mr. Knight, you are addressing legislative issues, okay? We have lanes that we have to remain within. Whether this court believes or doesn't believe that a statutory provision is appropriate or not appropriate is not this court, outside of the unconstitutionality of it. Judges are sworn to the Constitution, not to the laws. So the court has to follow the laws unless they are unconstitutional. So that's the law. The control of a trial, the length the length of a trial, is really controlled through the rules of evidence, and both parties have applied them time and again in this matter. Sometimes it extends things because of all the argument with regard to rules of evidence, but that's the gatekeeper. That is the thing that the court can only shorten a matter by removing an argument simply because it is not relevant, it's based upon hearsay, I mean, all those type of things that we've been talking about for the last 16 plus days. It would be totally inappropriate for the court to say, this case shall only take 10 days, period. But I can tell you right now, at the end of that 10 days and the court shut it off and the party that did not prevail appealed it, I can tell you right now that it would be right back down for a trial. So, because it is totally inappropriate. understands the frustrations. And what we have is what we have.
Okay.
Okay. That gets us to the matter that was brought to the court's attention. And because it was brought on the ex parte docket, I think it's appropriate for the court to frame this as to what the court experienced on the ex parte docket on, I don't know, I'm pulling up the case right now. On May 17th, which was 3 days ago. There was a ex parte request brought by Ms. Voss pursuant to a motion that she filed. And I'm pulling up the motion. Motion for an immediate restraining order was actually filed on the 16th, and it was before the court on the 17th. Even though I was not doing the ex parte docket that day, court administration recognized the case and placed it before me. I was on the bench already that afternoon. Ms. Voss brought her request. I literally did not hear argument. Told Ms. Voss that before the court was going to grant an ex parte or an immediate order, I needed to have Mr. Knight present. And so I took the proposed order, I struck everything that related to any kind of restraint and sent this matter over for this morning to be dealt with. And that's what we were going to do, we're going to deal with. And so a beginning point is, Mr. Knight, did you receive paperwork on this motion?
I just received paperwork on this motion in the proper fashion today. I never have ever accepted legal documentations being served to me electronically.
Okay. So you were physically served with these documents?
Today.
Today. You did see them electronically, but we all know the court rules. I gotta believe that unless the parties have an agreement, electronic service is never allowed. And so, and I'll hear from both parties in a moment. But what I've been grappling with is the notion of having to deal with a motion such as this pending a trial. The parties need to understand that judges work very hard to not reach a conclusion until all the evidence has been presented. And I have not, I don't even read these exhibits except for while you are arguing and you have an exhibit up, I will follow it along once it's submitted, at the very least, so that I have my notes are consistent between the exhibit and the testimony, and that's how I think I get things matched up. I don't consider.
I didn't understand that.
I don't know what's going on. Many electronics around here. The court does not analyze those exhibits, and I think it's inappropriate to do that up until the time of the last piece of evidence has been presented to this court. And it's important for the court to keep an open mind all the way to the end, because if the court court starts making a decision, what happens is it places into jeopardy the other evidence that will be presented. So far, I've only been hearing Ms. Voss's case in chief. I have not heard Mr. Knight's case in chief at all. And so that's an issue, in that by addressing a request for an immediate order, the court has a whole lot of background in this case, 16 days of background in this case. And the court has seen the documents that were attached to the motion. I couldn't tell you what exhibits they are, but I know I've seen them. And they may not have even been admitted. I don't know, but I know I've seen them. It is appropriate for this motion to be before me, and I recognize that, Mr. Knight, you asked specifically if you could bring a temporary motion for relocation. I said no, at least not before me, through somebody else. And that was the very reason why, because in that type of motion, the court has to make a determination of the likelihood of success, okay? In a temporary motion that's before the court does not have to make that determination. Doesn't have to make a determination of likelihood of success in the ultimate issue to deal with this piece. And so there is a distinction between the suggestion by Mr. Knight for the relocation order and Ms. Voss's current motion for immediate order that's pending before the court. So I do make that distinction, but I also recognize it is going to be very difficult for this court to characterize or to not to characterize to separate the evidence is being presented on this temporary order from a whole lot of evidence the court has also considered. Secondly, even if Mr. Knight would have been served in shortly after the court set this matter for hearing for this morning, he would have limited time to respond because it's not within the time period. I did not actually sign an order shortening time on that. So I do believe that the appropriate approach this morning would be to hear this in the framework of a ex parte motion. It's not truly ex parte because both parties are here, setting this matter for further hearing. So in other words, will the court grant the immediate relief requested? And then set for a full hearing, allowing Mr. Knight the opportunity to provide the documentation that he would normally be able to provide in the normal course. So I think that that is probably the appropriate way to proceed on this, because Mr. Knight has not had that opportunity.
Sir.
And I'm reluctant to open this up for testimony, which is my other consideration I had. So you had a question.
I have contacted Cynthia Johnson as soon as this had occurred. I informed her to contact Mason Clinic to talk to Therese. I believe she has. I'm waiting for an email from her because she's in trial in Grays Harbor starting at 8:30, and she has another trial at 1:30 today in Thurston County, and she may be available by Zoom at some time today, and I'm waiting for an email to see if that would be available, and that she would have direct contact with the doctor concerning this over the weekend.
Well, so any party at any time has a right to come before the court on a motion for an ex parte relief, what the court will need to decide this morning is whether an immediate order should be granted. And what I'm trying to contemplate is whether the court needs to hear from the guardian ad litem in that regard, because she is a party to this case. And any hearing on this matter, on a motion, she should also be served on. Did you serve Ms. Johnson?
I didn't. And if I'm intending to withdraw the motion because the crisis is past, sort of.
Well, we're just kind of going through a whole lot of discussion.
Waiting for an opportunity, and I could have piped in a lot earlier, I'm sorry.
Well, I didn't allow you to, so. Motion's withdrawn?
Yes.
We're gonna move on. And so, the clerk's minutes should reflect that the motion filed by Ms. Voss on May 16th is withdrawn.
I want to call CR 37 sanctions, or no, CR 11 sanctions on Ms. Voss.
What is the basis of your...
Ms.
Okay,
Voss.
This is what we're going to do on that. And so she's withdrawn the motion, but I also recognize that anytime CR 11 is triggered, a party has the ability to raise them. I'm just trying to figure out whether we need to deal with it right now or whether we will have you bring a formal motion for CR 11.
How about if I bring a formal motion with the next hearing for, or, well, she withdrew. Yeah, I still want a hearing.
This is what I'm going to have you do, Mr. Knight. I'm going to reserve your CR 11 request, I'm going to require a formal motion for CR 11.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. And then give Ms. Voss an opportunity to respond to those. Okay. So, clerk's minutes should further reflect that Mr. Knight's that the court is reserving the right of Mr. Knight to come back before the court on a CR 11 motion. Okay, so let's move forward with the trial now. And so our last day of trial, we ended with Ms. Voss completing her redirect of herself. Okay. So that means that, Mr. Knight, you have the ability, if you wish, again, we're looking at this pyramid of information that we can address, to recross Ms. Voss on the information that she addressed during her redirect. Do you wish to do that?
Yes, I have one here I'd like to talk to her about.
Okay. You may proceed.
And we're going to find that in 321. And it's identified at the bottom as Exhibit 112, page 20 of 23. It's a Gmail written by Ms. Voss.
Okay, just pause for a moment. Okay, so we're on 321. You said number 20 out of 23?
Yes.
Well, I'm not sure that's helpful because there's all sorts of numbering on this one.
Yeah, I don't remember. remember which subsection this one was in.
Oh, is it in a subsection?
I do believe it's in a subsection.
Oh, okay, that might make it easier.
What
and
is
it's
the
towards
date?
The end of it, last part of the of it. So it, the date is December 13th, 2021 at 6:54 p.m. on a Monday.
That's 321B. President Bowie?
Could you call 321B, please? Yes, it is 321B. Mr. Knight, do you have 321B up this?
Please? I do.
Okay, Mr. Knight, you may proceed.
Okay, should I provide it with her, or are we going to proceed like we had
it's
on Friday?
It's already been admitted.
Okay.
So as long as she has the bench copy, I'm okay with that.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So, Ms. Voss, can you identify this email?
Yes, this is an email from me to you, and your response. Dated December 13th, 2021. It's copied to Nathan Click and Davita Stafford at Catholic Community Services Wise and Ms. Johnson.
Isn't this the letter I had sent indicating that Davita, I didn't want Davita on the Wise team anymore? Or was beginning, yes. Can you read the last sentence of that Mr. Knight's response at the bottom of the page?
I will be asking for her to be removed and replaced with a professional replacement.
Yes. Was there a professional replacement put into place?
Davita Stafford was replaced with another therapist.
What was that therapist's name?
Maciel Aspirin.
I'm sorry, what?
Maciel Aspirin. A-S-P-R-O-N.
Doesn't Maciel have a Psych D degree in psychology?
That's what I was told. I still don't know exactly what that means.
Do you think a Psych D degree was superseded DeVita's educational standards?
I believe so, but it's unclear whether she's attained or is reaching for a psychologist degree.
Isn't it true that you have been treating Maciel the same way you treated Amanda Marquez through Consejo Counseling?
I don't know what you mean.
Don't you have the same contempt put forth towards Maciel as you were showing towards Amanda Marquez at Consejo Counseling?
That assumes that I was showing contempt.
Can you just speak up just a little
bit? I'm sorry. That assumes I was showing contempt towards Amanda, and I wasn't, I don't believe.
On this email here, this is concerning your refusal to transfer Chloe to her father, doesn't it?
This is my attempt to communicate with you about problems with Rice. If you want to frame it as my refusing, I can't stop you, but I did communicate that. On this date, as the email indicates, Rice was talking about suicide, and Rice had a standing appointment with Davita, and Dr. Rice talked to DeVita, we all agreed that listening to Rice on this day would have been best, and I attempted to initiate a conversation with you about that.
Ms. Voss, were you found in contempt for not transferring Chloe on that day?
I believe so.
Does DeVita have any say in the parenting plan as it is written?
No.
Is DeVita a decision maker in the parenting plan as it is written?
No.
Are you a decision maker in the plan as it is written around medical issues?
Emergency decisions are within my realm to some degree, and where the borders are on that is a little fuzzy.
Did DeVita consider this an emergency?
I don't know. We'd have to ask her.
Did you take Chloe to an emergency room on that day because she had threatened to commit suicide?
No.
Was there imminent harm showing for Chloe on that day?
Rice was talking about stabbing himself in the chest with a knife that day.
Did you feel the need to take Rice to the emergency room that day to find out if she may need some medication for her instability?
No, I talked to her therapist.
Is her therapist a doctor?
No.
Is her therapist an emergency medical technician?
Her therapist works as a crisis responder for WISE.
Is she an emergency medical technician?
I don't know.
Was that an emergency that day?
I felt it was emergent.
You felt it was an emergent, so you took it upon yourself to decide not to follow the parenting plan.
I felt it was in Rice's best interest to not visit with you that day, and DeVita agreed with Rice's request on that issue based on Rice's...
So you imposed on Rice that she was not to see Mr. Knight that day, and DeVita backed you on your decision?
No. That's not what I said. Rice said that if they had to go with you, they were...
Didn't you just state that...
She was in the middle of an answer, so you can continue with your answer.
Thank you.
And subject to any objection, but you didn't object. She's still going. Go ahead.
Rice had indicated that if they had to visit with you, they might just...
Objection, Your Honor. Hearsay.
Sustained.
Ms. Voss, didn't you just say that you had decided that it was not in Chloe's best interest to be with her father that day?
That is what we all decided.
That is what you all decided. So you admit you decided how Chloe was going to do that day simply from your choices.
I attempted to communicate the issue to you so that we could all come to an agreement.
Ms. Voss, does this sound like a trying to ask for an agreement, or is this just telling Mr. Knight what you were planning on doing?
I would appreciate your understanding and support in this, is the last sentence of my message.
So you're telling me to appreciate and do what you want me to do?
I would appreciate your understanding and support.
So you're requesting something from me and indicating that you are going to do it because you want me to follow along. Is that not correct?
No. No. I'm sorry, but I think I've asked and answered this question.
I think she has. Sustained.
Ms. Voss? On last Thursday, were we having a cross-examining you concerning the medication that Chloe was prescribed during this trial on March 29th and had only been on for a month? Were we not discussing this on Thursday?
I can't recall exactly which day it was, but it was certainly part of the prior testimony, yes.
Would it not be true that as of Friday afternoon,
none of the WISE team, the doctor, or Mr. Knight was aware of any negative influences of the medication on Chloe other than you taking Chloe to the walk-in clinic?
No, it's not true.
Isn't it true that the WISE team was not aware that you had taken Chloe to the walk-in clinic on Saturday?
I made the WISE team aware after the fact.
After Saturday?
Yes.
Which day did you make the WISE team aware?
I believe it was Monday.
So what time on Monday did you make the WISE team aware?
I don't recall.
Was that after Mr. Knight had already contacted the WISE team because the doctor had contacted Mr. Knight twice?
I wouldn't know when the doctor contacted you.
Ms. Foss, do you know all the information that comes out of the WISE team?
No.
Do you request all the information immediately?
No.
Do you have lots of requests at the WISE team and other medical providers to get information?
What I would characterize as lots of requests versus what you characterize as lots of requests are different. I believe I have two, maybe three requests to the WISE team, including subpoena and the records that have been provided.
Ms. Voss, do you feel that you are required to object to anything that Mr. Knight does? Do you feel that any medical decision Mr. Knight makes, you have to counter and do the opposite?
No.
Isn't it true that from your actions, it appears that is exactly what you have been doing?
No.
Isn't it true that on the 29th of March, Chloe was at Mason Clinic to be seen by Therese Pesset, I can't pronounce her last name, the nurse practitioner that prescribed Chloe her medication? Isn't it true that that happened on the 29th of March?
I've got a number of exhibits about this, including my request.
Yes or no, ma'am?
I'm attempting to answer your question.
Yes or no, ma'am?
I don't know. I would have to look at my notes to refresh my memory, and we've got a number of exhibits that could do that.
Ms. Foss. Your own notes that you just provided today has the date of 329 on your third page in.
Which exhibit?
It isn't an exhibit. She hasn't filed it yet. This is what she brought in today. She brought all the evidence in for it, and it's right here. If she wants to refresh her memory, she just delivered it today.
If a document has been marked, you can reference a document.
Okay. If it's been marked, it is 425.
Ms. Voss, do you have a copy of Exhibit 425?
I believe so.
Let me give this back to you. We can pull it, Ms. Fox.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I had my folders in the wrong way.
Okay, so you have Exhibit 425.
I believe so. I
or
do. Yes.
The document marked as Exhibit 425.
Yes.
Okay, now that we're all looking at the same document, Mr. Knight, you may proceed.
Thank you.
So, Ms. Voss, from this document, can you refresh your memory that you were at Mason Clinic on 3/29, the day that Chloe was prescribed medication for her extreme depression and anxiety?
Yes. I'm recalling that. I haven't found it yet, but yes, now.
Wouldn't that be on the third page? Where it's discussing how Hayden was going to the doctor's appointment. It just happened to occur at the same exact time as Chloe's appointment because you was having issues with Hayden that day?
Because you scheduled it that way is what I recall.
Did you not call Mr. Knight that day and state that Hayden was having back pains and needed to see the doctor immediately? So Mr. Knight was already going to the clinic, so he made an appointment so that both of them would be coinciding at the exact same time to reduce time?
I believe that's what I just stated, is that yes, you scheduled the appointments to coincide.
Isn't it true that when Chloe was prescribed the medication, after the decision was made, that you were allowed to go in and have direct communication with the prescribing doctor and was given handouts from the prescribing doctor on that day? Is that not true?
Therese Pizzanti, yes, but not the doctor that saw Hayden.
I am discussing Chloe and the medication that Chloe has received from her. Did you not receive and talk to the doctor that day?
I did. A nurse practitioner, but yes.
Wasn't it told to you by the nurse practitioner that the medication needed to be taken on every day at whatever time was chosen?
At the same time, every day, yes.
And wasn't that time chosen to be 9 o'clock?
Yes, that was Race's preference.
So.
9 p.m.
Isn't it true that you had custody or residential time with Chloe beginning on Monday of last week, which would be the first part of the month, correct?
I have to take a look at my phone to be sure.
Okay. In this file here, didn't Chloe have an incident with the school teacher?
Yes.
Was that after she had missed a couple of doses of her medication at your home?
No, it was after they missed a couple of doses at your home.
When did the incidents occur at the school?
Again.
That was on a Wednesday, was it not, Ms. Voss?
You want to point to where it says that in this record?
You supplied the records. You should know where it's at, Ms. Voss.
Mr. Knight, if you are asking this witness.
Okay, again, let's go to page.
Mr. Knight, I got to finish talking. Okay. When you wish to use a document to refresh a witness's memory, you should point to the portion of the document that you think will refresh the witness's memory.
Okay. Ms. Voss, can you go to page. Appears to be 5 of your emails that you submitted here.
The incident with Rice Monday, dated May 9th, 2022.
Yes. And the one on the 10th. Isn't it true that you had custody of Chloe on those days?
On May 9th and 10th? I believe so, but the other incidents.
During your custody period.
You answered the question, you can ask the next question.
During your custody period, was there an incident at the school with Chloe and a teacher?
There have been 2 incidents at the school. One during Rice's time with me and one during Rice's time with you.
Isn't it true, Ms. Voss, that you testified that you didn't want Chloe on that medication?
I testified that I had concerns based on information I had received. Yes.
So, wouldn't you agree that if Chloe had missed a couple of days of medication that she had been on for a month at in your care and had an incident at school, that would be a convenient way for you to blame a side effect on the drug to get her taken off of the drug? Is that not true?
No. And the timeline that you're asserting is not accurate.
Isn't it true that you took Chloe to Mason Clinic and had Chloe tell her provider that she no longer wants to be on the medication?
I brought Rice to the walk-in clinic on this past Saturday. I'm sorry. Yeah, it's Friday today. So, yes, this past Saturday, I brought Rice to the walk-in clinic. As directed by the triage nurse I spoke to the evening before, Friday evening, after Rice informed me that they were having thoughts, recurring thoughts, obsessed with the idea of seeing blood and thoughts of hurting others or themselves to see blood.
Ms. Foss, isn't it true that you're the only one that has ever stated that statement?
No, Rice is the first person.
Isn't it true that Mr. Knight has never heard Rice state anything like that?
I wouldn't know what you've heard or what you're willing to hear.
Isn't it true that that weekend, that Monday on transfer, I believe it was about the 9th, I think that was, that day Chloe had came out of her shell so nicely that she was down at the lake at time of transfer with the neighbor boys catching salamanders, having fun, and it was it ended up being a little late on transfer that day. Isn't that not true?
Are you referring to a week prior, before the medication was increased?
Ms.
Foss, I don't know what date you're talking about.
Was Chloe not ever late for transfer because she was having a good time at the lake with the neighbor boys catching salamanders? Was that never told to you?
I believe you may have reported something of the sort. On what day? I don't know.
So, Ms. Voss, with your control issues, wouldn't it be...
Objection. Inflammatory.
State Center psychological evaluations.
So the question is whether the questions are oftentimes inflammatory. That's the nature of a trial. The question is really whether there is an argument considered within the question. Arguments are not allowed. I haven't heard the question yet. So I'll allow Mr. Knight to continue.
Ms. Voss, isn't it true that your tendencies with control issues, that you chose to take Chloe off of this medication by waiting until she turned 13 on March 11th, and by March 14th, you had talked her into going into the clinic and asking her, telling her doctor to remove her from the medication? Is that not true?
I'm sorry, I'm going to have to object. I didn't hear the entire question because the argument asserted in the question is...
Objection, Your Honor. She's refusing to answer the question.
Wait a second. I have one objection. I hear that one first. Go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. The argument asserted within the question was erroneous, and therefore... just holding that objection in mind made it challenging for me to hear the rest of the question.
Okay, so first of all, this is cross-examination. It's nothing inappropriate by the question on cross-examination. So if you did not catch the whole question, I'll allow Mr. Knight to state the question again. But the nature of cross-examination is that it can cross into argumentative, but that wasn't.
Ms. Voss, isn't it true that your
control issues, apparent control issues, made you wait till Chloe turned 13 years of age on the 11th of March, and then you had been, at that point, you talked Chloe into going into the walk-in clinic and to her provider and getting off of the medication that was helping her. Isn't this true?
No, I do not have control issues.
Isn't it true that Chloe turned 13 on the 11th? Isn't it true that you took Chloe to the walk-in clinic on Saturday and had her tell the doctor she didn't want to be on the medication? And then you took Chloe to the provider who prescribed the medication on Monday and had her removed from the medication. Is this not true?
No.
Is Chloe taking the medication now?
The last I heard, you were trying to force Rice to take the medication.
Ms. Voss, is Chloe taking the medication now to the best of your knowledge?
The last I saw Rice was on Wednesday morning when I dropped them off at school. I later heard that you were trying to force them to take the medication against their will. I don't know what has happened since.
Ms. Voss, to the best of your knowledge, isn't it true you got the told Chloe to go to the doctor and get taken off of that medication?
I took Rice to the walk-in clinic as directed within 24 hours on Saturday morning, within 24 hours of the triage nurse directing me to do so on Friday evening. I brought Rice to the walk-in clinic. Rice communicated to the provider what they were experiencing, and the provider, based on that information, made a decision. I simply facilitated bringing Rice to the provider so that they could talk to someone about their mental health services and this medication.
Ms. Voss, during this trial from the very beginning, has Mr. Knight not been arguing the fact that Ms. Voss was going to take control of all of the children's medical stuff under the laws stating that the children can make their own medical mental health decision making at the age of 13? Is that not true?
You have been arguing that.
Did you just not prove my point by doing exactly that?
No, I believe you proved your point by forcing our child to take a medication knowing that it would have potential side effects that you denied. Knowing that I would report accurately, Rice would report accurately, and you would just flatly deny as if it, because that has been working since 2015, and that's how you got decision making, by denying symptoms after inducing the symptoms and saying, ignore mom, she's crazy.
Ms. Voss, by removing medications from a child and having a child go off on a teacher and then using it, going to the doctors to get her off that medication, wouldn't that mean that Ms. Voss induced the issue?
You're misrepresenting the facts. And the timeline.
Right now, because it is 10:30. Morning recess. We'll start up again at 10:45.
Your Honor, I printed out a timeline of all of this and left it at home. I guess I'll get it at lunchtime. I don't know that it's standing.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Thank you.